My name is Dr. Mark Roberts. I'm the executive director of Fuller's Max DePree Center for Leadership. We work with folk in the marketplace to help them live as disciples of Jesus in every part of life. We'll be looking today at the letters of 1st and 2nd Timothy, which actually combine my own personal interests. They're New Testament letters written by Paul to Timothy. They also have so much to say about leadership. They spoke once about the need of leadership in the first century, and they speak to us about what it means for us to be faithful leaders today. A couple years ago, my mom passed away, and as we were going through her belongings, we discovered a treasure. And I've actually got that treasure here today. Now you'll be disappointed. It's not gold and silver treasure. It's actually a bunch of letters. None of us in my family, not my siblings or I, had ever seen these letters. Turns out they are letters that my dad wrote to my mom while they were dating. The context is that my mom went to UCLA in Southern California. My dad was in college back at the University of Connecticut. My mom took a semester there. They met, fell in love, and then my mom went back to UCLA to continue her education. My dad stayed in Connecticut. And in that time of separation, he wrote her all these different letters that none of us had ever seen before. And this is really a treasure for our family, as you can imagine, to get to know my dad and his relationship with my mom at a time of life when we weren't around. You know, in many ways, the letters in the New Testament of 1st and 2nd Timothy are a similar kind of treasure. They're very personal letters. They're written by Paul, the apostle, probably most famous for his letters to churches like Romans and Galatians. But 1st and 2nd Timothy are personal letters written to Timothy. We know from Paul's letters that Timothy was one of his closest colleagues and co-workers. But their relationship is more than just a working relationship. In the letters that we'll be looking at, Paul refers to Timothy as my beloved child, my loyal child. There's a deep friendship, a deep connection between them. Paul wrote because they were finally separated, and Timothy was in what we would now call modern Turkey. And he was pastoring some churches that were going through some very challenging times. And so Paul wrote to this person, to his mentee, to someone he'd invested in and loved, to try and help him be an effective leader in churches going through such hard things. As we read these letters of my mom and dad, it was, of course, important to know the context if we're going to understand them, to know what was going on in their lives. And the same is true for Paul's letters to Timothy. But Paul makes that context very clear right away in the first letter. Paul gets immediately into the problem. And he tells Timothy that he's got to stay where he is so that he can instruct those who are teaching false doctrine and get them on the right track. Both of these letters are written in a time in which the church is really being threatened by people who claim to be Christian, but whose teaching is contrary to the very the essence of the Christian faith. As we try to dig through the letters and find out what exactly those folks were teaching, what we find is that it's kind of a combination of a sort of a Jewish version of asceticism. That is to say, it's about not eating certain foods, forbidding marriage even. But even more than that, there's what we call Gnosticism, from the Greek word gnosis, which is the word for knowledge. Gnostics and early Christian Gnostics believed that if you had just the right knowledge, you could basically transcend this world. Gnosticism didn't care about the physicality of life. Gnosticism didn't have a concern for justice or for the care for the earth or love for people. It was all about getting the right knowledge so you could personally transcend this world. But that was deeply opposing kind of the fundamental Christian commitment to this world and God's presence in this world. And so Paul wrote to help Timothy be a good leader in a time challenging to the church. And there's a lot in there that also helps us in our own challenging times in leadership. Paul lays out basically three main things for Timothy as a leader. First of all, he should lead by hanging on tightly to the core truth of the gospel. Many places in these letters, Paul will encourage Timothy to grasp the truth and teach the truth. He also makes it clear that this truth is absolutely connected to Scripture. In the second letter, he says that all Scripture is inspired by God and it's profitable for teaching and for righteousness. So Scripture is so important. Also, in the first letter, there's a very interesting line where Paul encourages Timothy to attend to what's usually translated the public reading of Scripture. It's the oral reading of Scripture in the context of the community that Paul is urging Timothy to do. And the very thing that we're about here and what we call the communal reading of Scripture, actually it grows out of that verse and the early Christian practice of listening and hearing and believing that God's Spirit speaks when we listen to God's Word. So first off, Timothy's to lead by hanging on to the core truth of the faith. Secondly, he is to lead by exercising personal integrity. There's a line in one of these letters where Paul says that Timothy should pay close attention to himself and to his teaching. In other words, it's not just about saying the true things, but it's about living them and being an example for others. So for Timothy to be a leader in challenging times, first, hanging on to scriptural truth. Second, living it, being an example. And third, Paul wants Timothy to raise up others, to empower others in leadership. Paul talks about how Timothy is to not only teach the truth, but entrust it to those who can be good stewards of the truth. So there's a delegating and an empowering leadership that's part of what Timothy needs to do. You know, most of us know the letters of 1st and 2nd Timothy, not so much from the whole letters as from certain verses that it might be memorized or quoted again and again. Growing up in my church, my pastor quoted 2 Timothy 1:7 probably 1,000 times. I'm not kidding. In the King James Version, it is, God hath not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and a sound mind. And I heard that growing up all my life, still love it. It's a great verse. So we might know these books from certain verses, but when we read or listen to all of the books straight on through, inevitably we hear things that are unfamiliar, maybe even things that are not altogether comfortable. And what's really important is to know that the reading of Scripture in community, the listening to Scripture, that's not the end of the process. It really is an invitation. It's an invitation to go deeper. It's an invitation to wrestle and struggle with the text. It's an invitation to ask again and again, what does God want to say to me and to us through this passage? Perhaps even more, the listening and reading of Scripture in community is an invitation to a deeper engagement with God. Part of what we get in this treasure of 1 and 2 Timothy are some amazing passages about God. And I'll close by reading one of them that comes from the end of the first letter, in which Paul speaks about God, who is the blessed and only sovereign, the King of kings and Lord of lords. It is he alone who has immortality and who dwells in unapproachable light, whom no one has ever seen or can see. To him be honor and eternal dominion. Amen. Amen indeed.